Figure we sing that two Sundays in a row, we'll get to know that just a little bit better. It's a beautiful song. It's a more contemporary or newer song. Herb Brokering, we're familiar with some of his other songs, and really lays together kind of the whole picture of, well, last things, what we know about last things, and where God's got us at right now, and what he's given to us already. We got the word. He tells us about what's going to come. He tells us about the past. He tells us about how he got here. He tells us about what he did in Christ Jesus. He tells us about the fact that we could come to the table, and when we're coming to the Lord's Supper, it's a foretaste of the feast to come. What's the feast to come? That's heaven. In heaven, we'll be served by Christ. In here, we're served by Christ too. So as we come together, it's all about last things, and the Bible really tells us a lot about eschatology, so that we're not taken, we're taken back. Like I said, it's kind of like looking. Jesus said, always look at the signs. You could tell this morning that you got up, when you got up and stepped outside, that it was not summer, right? Pretty obvious. Pretty obvious. Cold, leaves down, snow not flying yet. But, you know, you can read that. Jesus said, as you read the signs, also read the signs of our times. You, when you got up, you heard the news, and it was not all good news, right? There's killings and people dying and robberies and things like that. Signs of our time that this is not a permanent place, that something's gone dreadfully awry in God's creation and the way that he made the world. Something needs to happen. And of course, we know that something did happen, as we said in the Creed. Jesus Christ, born to the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, crucified, died, payment for sin, but also rose from the dead. And that's the truth too. Holy Spirit with us now, in working us into faith, working that faith in our hearts, giving us that hope and that peace. So if you want to, open your Bible to 1 Corinthians 15. We're going to work through that text, our epistle reading. There's a little outline in your bulletin. Great color for Thanksgiving, huh? You like that? See that great orange color? I love it. When I was a kid, all we had was like drab gray and white. But now we've got orange. So five facts I want to share with you. You know them already, but I want to remind you about them again. Because God is all about facts. He's all about telling us the truth. And I don't know about you, but I like facts. I like to hear the truth. The only time that I kind of get away from facts is when I go to the movies. You know, I don't get reality TV. I live reality every day and I pay for it, right? When I go to the movies, I want fantasy. I want things out of this world in that way. But when it comes to life, I want facts. Every once in a while, my kids will hit me and say, "Dad, quit asking so many questions," right? Because I just want to know more. I want to know more facts. I want to know from the doctor, what's the diagnosis? What can I do? What are my options? Things like that. Give me facts. Well, God is all about facts for us. And the Bible, let me remind you again and tell you again today, is fact. It's the truth about the way things are. It always has been and it always will be. Critics have tried many, many times to disprove the Bible, to say it was just all made up, it's all fairy tale, it's all fantasy, and they failed every single time. Every single time. There is no book that's ever been written that has withstood as much scrutiny as the Bible. And they've tried to disprove it, and it's never worked. It's fact. And that's good news for us. So we got the facts about how we were made, how we were created, how we got on this world, how things got so messed up, where sin comes from, and why I battle it every day, and you do too. I've got these decisions to make. Do I do the right thing? Do I do the wrong thing? I'm battling that all of the time, right? I'm being tempted. I see evil around me, things that scare me, things that frighten me, both in my mortality as well as what others can do to me. And all of those are spelled out for us in Scripture. But we're here, last Sunday of the church year, Christ the King Sunday, to remember that above all of that, Jesus reigns. He is all-powerful. He has conquered death for us. We can be at peace. And now, what do? Well, listen to the parable. Feeding, giving a drink of water, visiting, comforting, caring for people. You notice that as Jesus tells that parable, what separated the two? Well, what they did, right? Their actions. Where do those actions come from? They come from faith in Jesus. They come from following Jesus. Why do we follow him? Well, go to the sheet. If you remember from last time, that little bit of the backup from the outline last time, I gave you three things there. I said, the coming of the Lord, the end of the world, when Christ comes back, cannot be predicted. Don't try to predict it. Jesus says you can't, but it is certain. And we said, while it can't be predicted, it's predictable. And I don't know about you, but I like that about God, that God is predictable. I can predict that God is going to love me. I can predict that when I come to God and confess my sins to him, you know what's going to happen next? He's going to forgive me. I like that predictability. I can predict that when I feel alone and I cry out to God, he's going to hear me. I can predict that he's going to answer my prayer and he's going to do it in his way and in his time. I can predict that. That's a good thing. There's so much in life that is unpredictable that I cannot predict, but that I know. Secondly, we said dead or alive, whether I'm here on this earth or whether I'm with the Lord, Jesus is coming back and no one will miss it. And also that Jesus is Lord, he is ruler over those who are alive or those who are asleep in Jesus or those who are gone to hell. He is still Lord of all of them. So with that, go to the outline for today and the five facts that I want to remind you about today. In 1 Corinthians 15, if you're there, page 1222 in your Bible, Paul starts out with these words. He says, but in fact, okay? These are facts, friends, good facts. Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. So fact number one is Christ rose from the dead. Don't try to discount it. It has been tried to be discounted, right? But it's true that Christ rose from the dead. You want proof of that? Well, if you go earlier in chapter 15, Paul tells us this, that the resurrection of Jesus Christ, after he rose from the dead, he was seen by over 500 of the brethren. Now, just mentions the guys, you know, because sometimes us guys have trouble, you know, getting it through, right? It didn't even mention the women. The women knew it, right? Who were the first ones to the tomb when Jesus rises from the dead? Guess what? The women. The same women that were there when he was buried, so they saw exactly which tomb he was buried in, right? And they come back later on Easter morning, and they find he's not there. Guess what they do? They go back and tell the guys. Guess what the guys do? Nah, couldn't have happened. No way, right? Nothing has changed. Sorry, guys. But you want witnesses? 500 who witnessed Jesus alive. Was he just alive for one day? No, he's alive for 40 days. And in 40 days after he rises from the dead, he does miracles, he eats, he sleeps, he's with his people. People saw him. You want proof that he's really alive? Oh yeah, that's a fact based upon the evidence that we have there too. You want another fact? Remember the disciples? Remember those disciples, one of them denying him three times, hiding away? Where they're on Easter morning, they're in the upper room, they're behind locked doors, they're frightened. Jesus comes through the door, shows himself to them. All but one of them, because of that appearance, because they saw that Jesus rose from the dead and knew it was a fact, all but one of them die a martyr's death. Because people said to them, deny that Jesus rose from the dead, and they said, no way. You want some facts to prove that Christ rose from the dead? That, amongst other things, gives us that proof. All recorded in Scripture, all there in front of us. So as you think about that, think about how often, though, in our lives, we get confused about those facts about God that we know are true. For instance, when we go through a hard time, oftentimes we say, God, where are you? Because it feels like he's a long way away from us. Yet, what are the facts that we know? Jesus said, I'm with you always. Never will I leave you or forsake you. Those are the facts, and we remember those. Or when bad things happen and we struggle with evil that happens in the world, and we say, well, if God were a loving God, then why this? Well, don't ignore the fact. Does God love you? All over Scripture, right? As a child, you learn the song, Jesus what? Loves me, this I know. That's the facts, that's what we know. And don't let those facts be pushed out. Satan tried to convince Adam and Eve of that fact, that God really doesn't love them. If God really loved you, then why would he give you all these trees and say you can't eat from them? Not true. God loves you. Or in those times when we feel powerless and helpless, and it seems like God can't change or do something different to change that. Why did my loved one die or whatever? And we begin to feel like God is not almighty, but the fact is, he is. So base your faith upon the facts that you know that are true, despite the times when you may feel like they're not. These are the facts. Christ rose from the dead. He is with you always. He does love you. He is almighty, mightier than all. Second fact. Look at verses 21 to 22. Paul goes on to say, "For as by a man came death, Adam, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. Just as for as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive." So the second fact is Adam and I, that's you, me, are sinners and we die. I would say whenever we have a funeral, we have proof that that person was a sinner. Rock solid proof right there. Because sinners die. That's what happens. You and I are going to die because we're sinners. Only sinners die. And that's true. You could blame it on Adam. You can blame it on Adam and Eve all that you want. It won't make any difference. You're a sinner too. Right? And we can't control what we inherit. I tell my kids that all the time, right? I say, sorry, you got it from me and your mom, right? You just kind of inherit that. And the sin thing is also true too. That happens. And you can tell it too. Because I've been around a lot of people who have witnessed the death of their loved ones. And every time when it happens that they die, they say, man, it happened so quickly. I can't believe they're gone. It takes me by surprise. And death is like that, right? That's why when we come to that funeral and we witness that death of that loved one, there's just that sinking feeling, that hole that we feel. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. And that's not natural. That hurts. That's something that leaves us grieving. But I want you to know, and I'm so glad, that God is about commas, right? It doesn't just say, for as in Adam all die, period, and leave it there. No, there's a comma in that sentence. And there's a comma in so many other sentences. As in Adam all die, but in Christ shall all be made alive. Or I said the scripture from Romans 6, the wages of sin is death. It doesn't stop there. There's not a period there. It doesn't say that's where you're left. No, there's a comma there. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. I don't know about you, but I'm glad God's about commas, right? He doesn't leave us where we're at. The only time a period is Jesus screaming out from the cross, it is finished. It's paid for. Your sins are all paid for. Eternal life is bought for you, period. But here, as Scripture describes to us, our sad estate, it doesn't leave us there. The wages of sin is death, comma, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. It's a fact. Go to the third fact. In Christ, we as all those who are in Christ, those who have gone before us, rise from the dead. We do. Marie Schultz, for those of you who remember Marie Schultz, when someone would die in the congregation in the early years that I was here, sometimes I would say, well, we lost so-and-so, right? You know, it's kind of a common euphemism we use because we don't want to say the word die. And Marie would always give me that look when I would say, we lost so-and-so. And she would say to me, Pastor, they're not lost. We know exactly where they're at. They're not lost like they're straying out there somewhere and don't know where they're going. No, they're not lost. We feel lost, but they are not. Why? Because they rise in Christ. Remember Paul's words about those who die? He says they fall asleep in Jesus. And they do. They go to that place that Jesus said, I'm preparing for them in that many rooms place, right? John 14. And we know that's true. They are not lost. And we will rise from the dead, just as Christ rose from the dead. Merle brought it up as he read that reading there. Those wonderful words, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Alleluia. Why is that good news? Because if Christ rises, I rise too, and so do you. That's a fact. That's the truth. Because you see, Christ is the only exception to that rule that only sinners die. Because Christ, not a sinner, The perfect, sinless Son of God dies on the cross in our place. Why? Paul says God made him who had no sin to be sin for us. And that's why he dies. And by doing it, he wins for us something, the fact that we will rise from the dead too. But here's where things get flipped around a little bit in the whole fact category. Because seeing is not believing. What you and I see when someone dies is a casket. What you and I witness and see out at the cemetery is a body being lowered into the ground. What we see is not telling us the truth. That says they're gone, they're separated from us, but that's not the truth. Because when it comes to this fact, believing is seeing. What we believe there, what we proclaim there, is that death has not won the victory. That person we will see again. That God has changed their lowly bodies to be like his glorious body. And that one day we will see them. Like Thomas, who needed to see the hands and feet of Jesus, Jesus shows himself to us by faith. By faith we believe the opposite of what our eyes see. And by faith and believing, one day we will see that. We will witness that. We will see those loved ones again. We'll see a perfect, recreated world like it was with Adam and Eve before the fall into sin. Believing, we see so much. And even taking the words of Jesus, believing, we see that any single person that we serve, no matter who it is, no matter how small or insignificant it may seem, is actually serving Christ. Do you believe it? Jesus said so. And by believing, we see it. And so therefore, we see around us many opportunities to serve Jesus in the people that we serve, even in loving our enemies, serving Jesus, people whom Jesus died for and rose from the dead for, people that Jesus is seeking out to, oftentimes through us. We'll pray about that in just a moment. Fact number four, death will be destroyed. Verse 26, the last enemy to be destroyed is death. Death is not our friend. Death is not natural. Ask yourself, in the way you feel about when someone dies, that hole you have in your heart, that pain you feel, those tears that you cry, this is not natural. Death is never a part of God's plan. But one day, that enemy will be totally defeated. Our loved ones who are in heaven already have seen that victory, and one day we will see it too. And so we'll be with the Lord forever. And what does that leave us with? Well, fact number five. God will be and is all in all. Last night, a number of us got to celebrate along with Don and Yvonne Bloom their 50th wedding anniversary. It was a wonderful gathering of family and friends together there. And Don had some wonderful words to say about their marriage and stuff. And he had to say, you know what? We don't have a perfect marriage. We've had our ups and our downs. We've had our challenges. We've had our arguments and things like that. And so we have to say that about our lives, right? We are not perfect. We are not the all in all to each other. We cannot be. We are fallen human beings. But God is that all in all. He is everything he promises and more. He delivers everything he promises to us. He is everything he says he is to us. Always has been, always will be. And so he is our all in all. And that's eschatology, my friends. That's the study of the last things. That's the study of where we're going and what's going to happen. And he's given that to us so that we might be ever diligent in the things that God calls us to do every day. Like Jesus mentioned of those whom we welcome into heaven who were just every day being about that work, not even remembering what they're doing, just doing it because it comes natural. So be encouraged in that too. As you live out your Christian faith every day, as you do what comes natural to us as Christians, as followers of Jesus Christ, knowing last things where we end up and who we'll be with. Christ the King Sunday. Christ is King, King of Kings and Lord of Lords forever. Amen. Let's stand.